Okay, preparing for the time of trouble. Now, we've been hearing, at least I have been hearing about this time all my life. Have you? We've talked about being ready, all kinds of things. And now, all of a sudden, it seems like our world has changed. I mean, just within the last year or two, I'm seeing things that... I'm not saying that I was asleep before, but I've been startled, let's say. And not quite shocked, but wow. You know, these things are just about ready to happen. Can you imagine Jesus coming in the clouds of glory? Can you imagine persecution? All these things that we've talked about. I'm not going to be talking too much about signs of the times, but there's one thing I want to just bring it to your attention. You probably know about it already. In fact, Brother Carter almost, you know, he talked all the way around it, but didn't quite say the things that I was looking at in the speech. So we'll look at that. Ah, it works. How about that? Okay, on the internet, we saw this. Vatican advisor says America's founding document is outmoded. That's something. Here's some of the things that were written about it. This was written in the Jesuit journal, but I took this from something that was reporting. So I'm kind of once removed, so it's maybe not quite as secure, but... if this is anywhere near as truth of what's happening, you know, it's something that we need to take notice. Top Vatican advisor Jeffrey Sachs says that when Pope Francis visits the United States in September, and we all know that he's coming, we know that the Pope has been going around talking about Sunday everywhere. I've seen it in the news more than once. He will directly challenge the American idea of God-given rights embodied in the Declaration of Independence. Okay, this sentence is not in quotes, so this is somebody's interpretation. Okay, so this, you know, I should have gotten to the original article, but I think these sentiments are in what he talked about. Sachs' view is that the global organizations, such as the UN, must dictate the course of nations. And individual rights must be sacrificed for the greater good. We will need, in the end, to put real resources in support of our hopes. You know, and I look at that. Whose hopes? Well... he wrote, now here we do have a quote, a global tax on carbon-emitting fossil fuels might be the way to begin. Even a very small tax. Now, what does he consider a small tax? Well, for the United States, $845 billion, which is not too far from a trillion. You know, if that's a small tax, I wonder what the large taxes that they have planned for the future. The Pope will call on the world at the United Nations to join the crusade for a new world order. Rather than emphasize the absolute need for safeguarding individual rights in the face of government overreach and power, Sachs writes that the gospel teachings of humility, love, and justice, like the teachings of Aristotle, Buddha, and Confucius, can take us on a path to happiness. Can you imagine Aristotle, Buddha, and Confucius leading us to happiness? The plan is quite simple. World government through global taxes with a religious face to bring it about. So it looks like the Pope is going to be spearheading or trying to spearhead a movement for everybody to get on board the New World Order. And they're putting this religious face on everything. So this is the times that we're living in. I don't know if this is exactly what he has planned. We're going to see what happens in September. But I think it's time to seek the Lord if we haven't done so before. And I'm sure most of us have sought the Lord. But I know in myself, maybe I haven't sought him to the degree that I need to be. Here's a verse that we all know. Zephaniah 2, verse 3. This is slide 5, by the way. Seek ye the Lord, all ye meek of the earth, which have wrought his judgment. Seek righteousness, seek meekness. It may be ye shall be hid in the day of the Lord's anger. Now, as I look at this, and it's not quite worded like a promise, is it? It's more like a hope. Seek the Lord because he may hide me in that day. Isn't that? It might not be the kind of assurance, but yet there's a hope there. I found Psalms 33:18, this slide 6. And it says, behold, the eye of the Lord is upon them that fear him, upon them that hope in his mercy. You know, this is a real comfort to me. You know, if I'm seeking God, if I hope in his mercy, I know that he's watching me. There's something about coming to him that draws his attention to me, to all of us. And I put this in the same slide because I connect these together. Because when we hope, then when we seek the Lord and seek righteousness and are seeking meekness, it is with hope that we say, it may be that he may hide me. We're hoping in his mercy. And when we're doing this, God, the apple, we become the apple of his eye. And when I put these together, I see the beginnings of a promise. Something that we can hang on to, hold on to. Here's another verse you all know. Isaiah 55:6. Seek ye the Lord while he may be found. Call ye upon him while he is near. You know, the time is soon coming when it's going to be too late to call on God, isn't it? You know, Jesus, is it the Beatitudes, said, you know, many will seek. How does it read? Many will seek, but they will not be able to find me. I sometimes wonder, is it talking about this time after the close probation? When many people will seek to find God and Jesus, but they can't find him.
Too late.
Too late, yes. I think there's more meanings to this because we are our worst enemies. But I think there's something to this. We know that one day he won't be able to. We will not be able to find him. Here's another one. Jeremiah 29:13. And ye shall seek me and find me when ye shall search for me with all your heart. Now this is the first one I've looked at where actually it looks like it's a promise. He says, if you look for me with all your heart, you will find me. In my own experience, I've looked at this and I thought, you know, have I ever looked at him? Have I ever searched with all my heart? You know, I read the beginnings of our church, the pioneers, and how they prayed and how they studied. And Mrs. White says that those people at the end will more than equal, their experience will more than equal than the experience of the pioneers. Where does that put me? I like putting these things together. So I have all four verses here in slide 9. And I'm going to read these, and I might read portions of it. I might change a word. I might skip some things. But seek ye the Lord while he may be found. Call ye upon him while he is near. It may be ye shall find, ye shall be hid in the day of the Lord's anger. Because the eye of the Lord is upon them that fear him, upon them that hope in his mercy. And ye shall find me when ye shall search for me with all your heart. What was his name? He mentioned that we have lost the ability to study the Bible line upon line. You know, we do a lot of reading. I know I do.
Jack Barney.
Yes, Jack. Yes, that's right. Brother, what's his last name again?
Barney.
Barney. Okay, Brother Barney. This is just when we put things together, we get a richness that we don't get otherwise. And this is a message to myself, too, because I say, look, I need to study. You know, I've studied various kinds of things, but I don't do it as a rule. And I need to. I looked up the next group of scripture I'm going to look at is 1 Peter. Chapter 1, verses 3 to 7. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which according to his abundant mercy hath begotten us again unto a lively hope. Now here's this hope again, but it's not just, you know, a lackadaisical hope or just, you know, we're just hanging on by a bare thread or whatever. This is a lively hope. Which according to his abundant mercy hath begotten us again unto a lively hope by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled that fadeth not, reserved in heaven for you. How can it not be a lively hope with a message like that? Who are kept by the power of God, read in verse 5, through faith unto salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time, wherein ye greatly rejoice. Are we rejoicing greatly? Is it a lively hope? And by the way, When I work on a sermon, it's, you know, what do I need? These are my problems. Have I really given myself fully to God so that the hope of his soon coming is a lively hope within me? That I rejoice in the Lord, that it means everything to me. Is that our experience? Going on in verse 6. Though now for a season, if need be, ye are in heaviness through manifold temptations. You know, we have some birth pangs to go through, don't we? We know it's coming. And it's something that must happen. Now let's read verse 7. That the trial of your faith, being much more precious than than of gold that perisheth, though it be tried with fire, might be found unto praise and honor and glory at the appearance of Jesus Christ. Now, what is it that's more precious than gold? It's not rhetorical. I want some feedback here. What is it that God wants from us?
Our hearts.
Our hearts, okay.
Our character.
Yes? I'm all ears.
Our whole being.
Our whole being. I was thinking of the experience, you know, that the trial of your faith, there's an experience that we're going through, being much more precious than gold. Now, if we go through the experience and we keep failing, do we gain anything? If we keep failing and not overcoming our sins, are we being triumphant?
No.
Would it be something that might be found unto praise and honor and glory at the appearing of Jesus Christ? Is it something to rejoice in when we find that we're failing?
No.
That happiness, you know, the presence of the Holy Spirit working in your own life for some reason isn't working. If that isn't happening, is there a joy within us? See, there's one other thing. This center part, you know, more precious than gold that perisheth, though it be tried with fire. Now, what does that suggest? We're going to be tried to the utmost. But something that is tried in the fire, in the language kind of, it's associated with being victorious. In other words, if you put gold in the fire, you know, the pure gold is purified and the dross and the wickedness and the sin is destroyed. Though we be tried in the fire, we're talking about the righteous. The righteous are tried in the fire. These are the ones that are victorious. These are the ones who can praise and honor and give glory when Jesus appears. There's an experience here, a triumphant experience that God's people will experience. If we don't overcome, there's going to be no benefit. So the trial of our faith, the experience that God wants from us, is to result in victory. Here's in Maranatha, page 161, paragraph 5 and 6, looking at the last part of chapter 5. We should now pray most earnestly, and of course it says now, doesn't it? We should now pray most earnestly, that we may be prepared for the struggles of the great day of God's preparation. Those who place themselves under God's control to be led and guided by Him will catch the steady tread of the events ordained by Him to take place. Now, what's that saying? If we place ourselves under God's control, we will catch the steady tread of events. Now, what's that? What?
We'll discern the times.
We'll discern the times. Just like what we looked at earlier and what Brother Carter, he looked at, he showed us a whole bunch of things. We can discern the times. But it doesn't just say the workings of the devil. It says the steady tread of the events ordained by him. You know, not only is God ordaining or allowing Satan to do his work, but God is going to be doing a work as well. And I believe this includes the working of God in our hearts. and events around us which should and will stir the righteous to be doing what they should be doing. And we're going to see this. Inspired with the spirit of Him who gave His life for the life of the world, that's Jesus, they will no longer stand still in impotency, pointing to what they cannot do. Now, what are we doing now? You know, I take the cake. You know, here I'm a call porter. I'm telling everybody I'm call portering. I've been sick, and the trauma of forgetting what I'm talking about right in the middle of a canvas, or, you know, I've been pretty sick. You know, it's too much. I know I'm going to really work on this stuff and try to get better, and I have gotten better. I'm a lot better. But each one of us faces trauma when we go out and meet with people. Fred, he has given us so many examples of what he has done. This is what we all need to be doing. Well, those who place themselves under God's control, they will be inspired with the spirit of Him who gave His life for the life of the world. They will no longer stand in impotency, pointing to what they cannot do. Instead, going on, putting on the armor of heaven, they will go forth to the warfare, willing to do and dare for God, even if it puts you in prison, even if it, you know, knowing that His omnipotence will supply their need, no matter what the situation. Now, I find something else very interesting in this selection. I see that the preparation for the last days, preparation for this time, involves going forth to the warfare. Can you see that? They're connected. They're interleaved with each other. If you have one, you're going to have the other. And if you don't have the other or the first, you're not going to have the other, if that makes sense. We need to think about that. So it's through preparation, placing ourselves under God's control, that we will be able to put on the armor of heaven and go forth in warfare. And this will allow us to go to do God's work effectively in the way that we should be doing now, but haven't so far. I'm going ahead of myself. I want to backtrack a little bit. Time. Okay. I have a website and lots of pages. Presently, I'm talking to somebody in England, and he's really struggling. Although he's learning a lot of new things, but you know, for instance, we look at the book of Job. We see Job answers a lot of questions for us. We see the great controversy, and we see so many things. And then when you start looking at the rest of the Bible, things click. But my friend, he wants to believe that God is loving, but he has a trouble with the book of Job. And this is his question. How can God and Satan toy around with a mere man just to prove a point? You know, he's confused, isn't he? We know that these aren't just small points. That Jesus is fighting the battle over the law of God. He's fighting for the survival of the whole universe. And the survival of God's people. And without going, this is our background. We, as Adventists, we know what the great controversy is. And we know the issues and what the book of Job is really looking at. But my friend doesn't have this great controversy understanding of things. Another question that my friend has. He says, is God so loving that He allows Lucifer or the devil to exist? Does God need Satan to exist for a reason? Why isn't the devil destroyed? Why did God even make Satan? But see, these are intricate things that we understand as Adventists. We put these things together. And it's a blessing. And this understanding, I think, is essential for a salvation. Because it's not just point, this point or that point. It's all the parts coming together. Another thing, just one more thing, and then I'm going to go on. Another point that he wonders about, he's been looking at demons, disemboweled spirits, fallen angels, irredeemable beings. Have you heard of that one? Or hybrid creations? You're talking about UFO people and all this kind of stuff. And he actually believes that God has created irredeemable creatures. Like, you know, he looks at gargoyles and I don't even know the names of all the hideous things that are written. But he has read a lot of Christian literature. But he doesn't realize that what he's really studying is paganism. You know, the Christian church is so infused with paganism. Either like with the Catholic Church, it's virtually almost 100%, but with Christian terminology. Or you have the daughters, which have partial paganism. They follow the Bible and lots of things, but yet the confusing aspects are still there, aren't they? So it's no wonder he's confused. This might be a wild, extreme case, but maybe not. You know, this is a person out there, especially like in Europe. The kinds of things that have been, the ideas that have been tossed back and forth, they are in utter darkness. And Satan has worked to confuse the whole world in various ways. He has so many ways, so many versions of darkness. He has darkness for everybody. But I believe, and I know you do too, that God needed a special people with a special knowledge in the last days. He had to. Virtually, I don't know of any other group that really understands the Bible. Everything is confused with darkness, with paganism. And so back in the 1800s, he led the early Adventists to a better understanding of present truth. He did that. Okay, we're ready for this quote now. This is slide 12. In the early days, and we have seen these quotes over and over again, but this is one I haven't seen too much, and it makes certain points I wish to bring out. In the early days of the message, when our numbers were few, we studied diligently. I guess you have the screen on the board. Okay. We studied diligently to understand the meaning of many scriptures. At times it seemed as if no explanation could be given. My mind seemed to be locked to an understanding of the word. But when our brethren who had assembled for study came to a point where they couldn't go no further, I'm going to stop here. I grew up in Tacoma Park, Maryland. I went to J&A Elementary School, John Evans Andrews School. In third grade, we had a field day. We went, one day they had grades 1 through 4 go to the White Estates, and then it was 5 through 8 the next day. And so we all went to the White Estates. I can remember going in there, peering into the vault, and wow, all the letters that she actually wrote is in here. And then they brought out that Bible, you know, that she held up for, is it 20 or 30 minutes? Or I'm not sure how long she held it up. And so they, you know, made it interesting for the kids and for us. And so, how long can you hold this Bible up, you know, with both hands, you know? And so various ones, you know, tried to, and I don't remember how long. It wasn't very long at all. It's a big book. So I can remember that day fairly well. There's something else that I remember as well. They said, and I can remember this to this day, they said, that Mrs. White never had any part in coming up with our doctrines. Have you heard that? That she only confirmed what the elders or what the people discovered in their Bible study. So after they found the answers, then Mrs. White had a vision and said, yes, we're right, we're going in the right direction. And since then, I found that that was a lie. Okay, we came to a point, looking at the green text again, where they could go no further and had recourse to earnest prayer. The Spirit of God would rest upon me, and I would be taken off in vision and be instructed in regard to the relation of Scripture to Scripture. These experiences were repeated over and over and over again. You see that? Did this happen once?
No.
It happened over and over. This was a process. Thus, going on, many truths of the third angel's message were established point by point. So, God took full control of our church and made sure that we had the full gospel, the full message, that we had everything we needed to survive, our spiritual survival. Okay, now, the rest of this I don't have in a special color, but it's probably one of the most important parts of this quote. And this shows Mrs. White's own understanding, her feeling for this whole topic. Think you that my faith in this message will ever waver? Think you that I can remain silent when I see an effort being made to sweep away the pillars, the foundation pillars of our faith? I am as thoroughly established in these truths as it is possible for a person to be. I can never forget the experience I have passed through. God has confirmed my belief by many evidences of His power. You know, it's because God has led us as a church that we have the truth for these last days. Just going to look at just the outline text, the red text, slide 13. This is Review and Herald, June 14, 1906, paragraph 19. Some of the instruction found in these pages were given under circumstances so remarkable as to evidence the wonder-working power of God in behalf of His truth. Sometimes, and she talks about how she stopped breathing. She had various kinds of things happen. It was while there was no sign of any breathing that I kept talking of things that were being presented before me. I have found evidence in the Old Testament that in some of the early prophets had the same kind of thing. I don't have it here, but I've seen that. So maybe there's significance as to how and why she had her visions. Okay, here's another quote of the process. A transforming power attended the proclamation of the first, second angel's message. It says, as it attends the message of the third angel, and this is, I'm sorry, second selected message is 109, paragraph 3. Lasting convictions were made upon human minds. The power of the Holy Spirit was manifested. There was diligent study of the scriptures. And don't think for a moment that they just sat around waiting for God to tell them what truth was. They had to put the effort out. They had to do the Bible study. And when they could find no more, they were stuck, that was when God acted and he set them in the right direction. I'm going to read the blue part again. The power of the Holy Spirit was manifested. There was a diligent study of the scriptures, point by point. Almost entire nights were devoted to earnest searching of the word. We searched for the truth as for a hidden treasure. The Lord revealed himself to us. Light was shed on the prophecies, and we knew that we received divine instruction. And this is just two rather short quotes, but there are many other places. You put all these together, and you know that we have been led by God. Now, if our church began by a study of the scriptures, you know, the people came together, and we didn't have any special leading, and we had Bible study, we came up with truths. Well, if that happened, I could readily imagine that, well, one day, you know, we might discover new truths, and wow, this is neat. We need to change our understanding. We need to, you know, and I'm not talking about anything. I'm talking about the basic pillars of our faith, okay? That needs to be understood. The very things that we've been instructed about. But if it was just our own study, like all the other churches, well, our knowledge could increase, and we might expect change as time goes on. And I think that's what the church presents to the Adventist membership, because of course Mrs. White had nothing to do with our coming up with our doctrines. But now, the early Adventists were instructed by Jesus through an angel and through Mrs. White, and they were led to a proper understanding of a group of understanding. You know, we have the sanctuary service. We have how Jesus came down. We have who God is, who Jesus is, and that he became our example, that he became human. We also have the three angels' messages, and when we put all these things together with things I'm not mentioning, they present a picture, a mosaic. And everything has to be there because they add to the one adds to the understanding of the other. So if this is true, and it is, how could we even think of changing our major doctrines? As a people, we're to stand firm on the platform of eternal truth. So this is eternal truth. That has, first selected messages, page 201. As a people, we are to stand firm on the platform of eternal truth that has withstood test and trial. We are to hold to the sure pillars of our faith, the principles of truth that God has revealed to us, are our only true foundation. They have made us what we are. The lapse of time has not lessened the value. I think of the road to Emmaus. Remember, there were a couple of disappointed disciples. And I'm sure they knew all the right scripture, but they had no way to put these things together. And then Jesus arrives on the scene. They don't know who it is, and he doesn't just, you know, I'm Jesus, you know, you're, you know, why are you so lacking of faith, or what he could have said. He didn't do that. He started to explain the scriptures. And I believe that when he started to explain these scriptures, that the truth became self-evident.
Amen.
The truth was in the scriptures. And all Jesus did was show them what was already there. And I believe that's the same thing that happened in the early church, in our church. When they were stuck, Mrs. White was given a vision, and they were led to a better understanding, and they could read these scriptures, and wow, this goes with this, and there's an understanding. And we can read these things today, and we can read the Bible, and there is so much understanding that we have that nobody else has. We have been given this special help. I'm going to skip slide 16 and go to slide 17. The theme of greatest importance is the third angel's messages. And, you know, when I was a kid, you know, the pastor would ask a question like, I can't remember exactly what they had asked, but, you know, what's our purpose? What are we to do? What's the message that we need to present to the world? Preach the three angels' messages. That was automatic when I was a kid. Later on, there's the beginning of confusion. Some of the room I heard preach the three angels' messages, and the other one, what was the other one? Do you know what that, the other alternative question was?
Sabbath.
What?
Sabbath?
No. It was preach salvation by faith. Preach the gospel. Preach the gospel. And the salvation by faith and all this kind of, it's not being righteous. But it was a reason for not doing anything. You know, it's like being all the other churches. And so this idea of the three angels' messages were forgotten during my time. So the theme of greatest importance is the three angels' messages. Embracing the messages of the first and second angels, all should understand the truths contained in these messages and demonstrate them in daily life. For this is essential to salvation. We shall have to study earnestly, prayerfully, in order to understand these grand truths. Now, my friend, you know, does he understand that God is very soon going to destroy the world, all evil? And if we have the evil within ourselves, that he'll destroy us as well? How about the Christian community? All the churches out there, do they have this understanding?
What understanding?
The understanding that the three angels' messages is important. And I might be getting ahead of myself. They don't understand that God is going to come and destroy evil. But not only that, but if we have any evil sins in our lives, we will be destroyed as well. So we must not have any remaining sin in us. And the sanctuary service, the three angels' messages, all embody this kind of understanding. And so these things are essential to salvation. How about Adventists? Do they have this understanding anymore? Many do not. And sometimes I've wondered about myself. I've understood this. But it's almost as if, maybe I don't quite think about it. God will, help me along, and now somehow he'll do it automatically for me. I'm not sure how I think about it, but maybe some of us have problems with this idea of getting rid of sin, because maybe we aren't doing it with the urgency that we need to be doing it with. Slide 18. The Lord has been pleased to give his people the third angel's message as a testing message to bear to the world. Now, obviously, this will be a testing message to everybody in this world. But is this a testing message to us as well? And are we going to be tested at the same time that the world is tested? Well, if we're to give the message... See, the right answer is popping out. If we're to give the message, we need to be settled in these things and to live these things before that happens. Going on, John beholds a people distinct and separate from the world who refuse to worship the beast or his image, who bear God's sign, keeping holy his Sabbath. I put these two quotes together because they relate to each other. I'm looking at Christian Service, page 41, and then later we'll be looking at First Testimonies, page 496. This is one of those 1 in 20 statements that I'm sure we've heard. It is a solemn statement that I make to the church, that not 1 in 20 whose names are registered upon the church books are prepared to close their earthly history and would be as verily without God and without hope in the world as a common sinner. So most of the Adventists are essentially going to be destroyed along with the utter wicked of the earth. And the second statement, I know it says to the young Sabbath keepers, but I relate these together. One kind of explains the other. Young Sabbath keepers are given to pleasure seeking. I saw that there is not 1 in 20 who knows what experimental religion is. And it might be because of our lack of struggling with God. And like I said initially, the early pioneers, they prayed. They studied. She says that in the last days that they will more than equal what was experienced then. But there will be many who will not have this experimental religion. And so they will be without hope. And we must not be among this group. I keep telling myself, I cannot be. And I know you believe the same way as I do. Philippians 2:12, we all know very well. Therefore, my beloved, as you have always obeyed, not as in my presence only, but now much more in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. So this is it's a fearful time. It's an awesome time. Now let's look at the early writings statement, which I paired along with Philippians 2:12. This is early writings, page 118, chapter 1. I then saw the third angel, said my accompanying angel. Fearful is his work. Awful is his mission. He is the angel that is to select the wheat from the tares, and seal or bind the wheat for the heavenly gardener. These things should engross the whole mind, the whole attention. Now obviously that relates to working out our own salvation with fear and trembling. This is an awesome subject, and it involves our future. See, I was going to say something. Oh, yes. Pays to look at my notes every once in a while. This reminds me of the early writings. You know, this third angel who decides who is sealed and who is to be burnt reminds me a lot of Ezekiel 9. Does that ring a bell? Where there's an angel that's going to mark those who are crying and sighing. There's so many different topics in the Bible that really come together. And I do a lot of reading, like Jack said yesterday or the day before, whenever it was, you know, we do a lot of reading and not a lot of Bible study. I'm one of these people. And we need to be putting these things together. Getting the greater benefit that is ours to obtain. And it may look like I'm quoting texts that refer to completely different kinds of topics. For instance, we talked about the three angels' messages. We're talking about working out our salvation with fear and trembling. And this next quote, which is different. Let's see, my accompanying angel. This is early writing 64, paragraph 1. My accompanying angel said, time is almost finished. Do you reflect the lovely image of Jesus as you should? And coming down to the other red text. Well, maybe I won't skip this part. Then I was pointed to the earth and saw that there would have to be a getting ready among those who have of late embrace the third angel's message, said the angel. Get ready, get ready, get ready. Ye will have to die a greater death to the world than ye have ever yet died. I saw that there was a great work to do for them, and but little time in which to do it. Now, she's talking about people who of late have embraced the third angel's message. But how about those of, I'm a fourth generation Adventist, and I've been in the message for a long time, and this especially talks to me, and maybe many, most, or all of you. We're not ready. I believe that. We will have to die a greater death to the world than ye have ever died. Whoops, I kept it down too long. Well, we're going to 22? Okay. Get this upside down. Okay. The third angel. This is Christian Education, page 45, paragraph 1. The third angel is presented, is flying in the midst of the heavens, showing that the message is to go forth throughout the length and breadth of the earth. It is the most solemn message ever given to mortals. And skipping down to the other red text. They must be proved to see if they will bear the test. And unless there is developed a firm, conscientious principle, to be all that God would have them to be. Now, are we all that we could be? We need to have that principle, a determination to be all that we can be in the Lord. And this is not just, you know, lifting ourselves up by our bootstraps. This is Bible study, study. This is urgent prayer to God. Asking for help in the process of joining, you know, God's or Christ's righteous hand. We can use divinity in this work. God leads his people on step by step. He brings them up to different points which are calculated to manifest what is in the heart. Some endure for at one point, but fall at the next. At every advanced point, the heart is tested and tried a little closer. Now, we've all had experiences, and we look back, and yes, we've been able to witness for God. We've passed this test, or we've been able to do away with this. Because originally that was we loved that more than God, and we had to get rid of that. Going on, if the professed people of God find their hearts opposed to the straight work of God, it should convince them that they have a work to do to overcome or to be spurred out of the mouth of the Lord. Said the angel, God will bring his work closer and closer to test them and prove every one of his people. Some are willing to receive one point, but when God brings them to another testing point, they shrink from it and stand back because they find it strikes directly at some cherished idol. Here they have opportunity to see what is in their hearts that shuts out Jesus. They prize something higher than the truth. So do we prize anything more than the truth? Going on, and their hearts are not prepared to receive Jesus. Individuals are tested and proved a length of time to see if they will sacrifice their idols and heed the counsel of the true witness, if they will not be purified through obeying the truth and overcome their selfishness, their pride and evil passions. The angels of God have their charge. They are joined to their idols. Let them alone. And they pass on to their work, leaving them with their evil traits, unsubdued to the control of evil angels. Those who come up to every point and stand every test and overcome, be the price what it may, have heeded the counsel of the true witness, and they will be fitted by the latter rain for translation. Now, because we've stood up for God in the past, obviously, is no guarantee that we're going to continue. We're going to have to fight every step along the way, and we'll be tested at every step along the way. Okay, I have two more quotes. Let's look at them quickly, but this is important too. I'll read this first, and then we'll talk about Elder White. I was shown that if God's people make no efforts on their part, but wait for the refreshing. Okay, what's the refreshing? The latter rain. Okay. So, if we wait for that time, it's too late. It's too late. We need to be doing these things now. I was shown that if God's people make no efforts on their part, but wait for the refreshing to come upon them and remove their wrongs and correct their errors, if they depend upon that to cleanse them from filthiness of the flesh and spirit and fit them to engage in the loud cry of the third angel, they will be found wanting. The refreshing or power of God comes only on those who have prepared themselves beforehand. I added that word, beforehand. For it is by doing the work which God bids them, namely, cleansing themselves from all filthiness of the flesh and spirit, perfecting holiness in the fear of God. Okay, my last quote. This is 1 Testimonies, it's the second paragraph of on 1 Testimonies 6:19. So this is a progression So just look at the first paragraph and keep reading. Okay, we're looking at Elder White. Elder White was sick, and he had a tendency to say, well, I'm sick, I can't do anything. Let's read. I was shown that in some respects, my husband's case is similar to that of those waiting for the refreshing. If he should wait for the power of God to come upon his body to feel that he was made whole before he made efforts in accordance with his faith, saying, when the Lord heals me, I will believe and do this or that, he might continue to wait and would realize no change. For the fulfillment of God's promise is only realized by those who believe and then work in accordance with their faith. And this is righteousness by faith. It's nothing about feeling. It's having faith, knowing what the truth is, and walking out in it. I'm going to read that part again. For the fulfillment of God's promise is only realized by those who believe and then work in accordance with their faith. I saw that he must believe God's word, that his promises are for him to claim, and they will never, no, never fail. He should walk out by faith, relying upon the evidences that God has been pleased to give and work, as much as possible to point to the point of becoming a well man. So what does that say about us? I'm not to wait until I'm well enough to go out and call Porter. Like I said before, this sermon's for me. Okay? It's for all of us, I believe. Are we taking God at his word, even when we don't feel like we want to or should do, or we don't have, oh, I don't feel the faith, you know? And, you know, obviously that's not it. We need to walk out in faith. That is my prayer for myself and for you.
Amen.
Let's pray. Kind Heavenly Father, thank you so much for loving us so much that you are leading us step by step. You've even taught us what your holy book teaches us, so that we can have a deep communion with you, and that we can take part in your work and be effective because your Holy Spirit is in us, that we will have the testimony of Jesus, that people will see something in us. Oh, Father, help us to be of this number, because if we aren't, somebody else will have that privilege. Help us to have that privilege, Father. Help us to seek for it, to struggle for it. Yes, we'll be tested over this, Father. Help us to be victorious over this test. Because you love us so much, Father. You don't want us to leave, to not win over these things. And you've given us all the power that is necessary. Your grace is sufficient for us. Praise God. Thank you so much. In the name of Jesus, we ask this. Amen.
Amen.